How many of you are law students? Okay, quite a small number. That's good, because these days I am not teaching law students. Through my legal awareness web series, which you must have seen on YouTube, I am trying to teach law to non-law students. So that's good. Law students are not here. In any case, is it not surprising that the constitutional law syllabus of law faculty doesn't have citizenship as a topic? Can you believe it? And it is not a topic not only in Aligarh, in many other law schools also. And that means we take citizenship question for granted, which is not right. Now, when I was here many, many years ago, and the first work which I did was on strict liability, and I opposed it tooth and nail, and I continue to oppose, because I feel people should not be punished for committing a crime if their mind was not at fault. So you must make the mental query, not only that you did the prohibited act, ki kisi ki aapne pen chura liya ya mobile chura liya, you must have intent to steal. Now, why did I oppose strict liability? I opposed it because I feel it is violation of due process. It is negation of rule of law. We should punish people only when both, as in law we say, actus reus as well as mens rea are presented. In the same work, I also wrote one chapter on burden of proof, and I opposed that, at that time it was an emerging trend, the shift in classical principle of burden of proof. Now, the classical principle of burden of proof is, in criminal law, since you are accusing me, and I have written it number of times, that criminal law is an instrument of a state. It is the state which prosecutes. So the parties are uneven. You don't have same level playing field for both the parties. So one party is a state which makes laws, which controls police, which controls CBI, ED, this and that. The judges are appointed by it, and then you are put in its institutions in detention, jail or police custody. So since a state has so much of power at its disposal, a poor little accused is powerless as soon as you start the case. And therefore, the principle which was developed, which many people in the rightist parties today criticize and don't understand the logic of it, the whole concept of that let hundreds of criminals go unpunished, but one innocent person should not be put to gallows, is this. Because legal system stand to gain if some people who committed crime are not punished. But legal system will lose a lot, because the respect of law will go down if one innocent person is put to death. And similar is the case with the citizenship issue, that my citizenship must be presumed in the same way as my innocence is to be presumed in a criminal justice system. You have to prove that I have committed this crime, and your burden is not a light burden, it is a heavier burden. You have to prove it beyond any shadow of doubt. And if there is slightest doubt, the case must be decided in my favor. I feel by shifting this burden on the issue of citizenship, we are starting a very, very dangerous trend in our country. When I was appointed as registrar in Aligarh, that was many, many years ago, almost 15 years ago or so, I said I will do computerization of only one file. This was the service file of our teachers and non-teaching employees. As you know, registrar has nothing to do with the students. There is no relationship between registrar and his students. So I was concerned only with our registrar is a head of a non-teaching staff, and of course he has to deal with the, as secretary of the university, with the teachers. So my concern was, and how it all started. It all started because within the second week, when I was walking in my office, I saw two elderly people. One was not really able to walk, and I said, "What is the matter?" And he said, "Sir, I retired about 10 months ago, but my pension has not been released." And then I found out that there was a problem of date of birth and service record and tallying of service record. So I said, everyone should quickly, ideally within 3 months of retirement, should get his pension. Believe me, ladies and gentlemen, many professors, I'm not talking of ordinary people, these are not Vadud illiterate laborers in Assam. I am talking of people who had put in 35 years of service in the university. There was no document of their date of birth proof. And I had to take affidavits of number of people to decide their date of retirement. And there were cases where younger brother retired early and the elder brother continued in the service. There were cases of sisters between whom the age difference was some 5.5 months, which is not humanly possible if parents are the same. So you had all kinds of cases. Proving something through a document and making that stringent scrutiny of document is indeed very, very dangerous. Now, we live in a times where if you lie 100 times, it becomes truth. And we have seen it in number of cases. So there are senior political leaders calling these people as termite. You know, in 40s, Hitler was also calling some people as cockroaches. So you can see that kind of similarity. My whole problem on the whole question of citizenship, and I'm happy that you said I don't want to go into the nitty-gritty of Assam, but do we really understand what is the whole idea of citizenship? Somebody who takes the pride of saying Vasudev Kutumbakam, the whole world is my family, how can you have NRC and see X is not from me and Y is not from me? Because it negates the very idea of Hinduism. The very idea of Hindu culture and Hinduism is the whole world is one family. If I can make it more specific, the whole idea of Akhand Bharat, Pura De Vishw Aapka Bhai Nahi Hai, Chaliye Aap Usse Zara Thode Kam Mein Hai. If you believe in the idea of Akhand Bharat and you think Pakistan and Bangladesh are part of India, which I also feel that they are part of India, and the partition was artificial and partition was wrong, and the whole two-nation theory was wrong, but who brought in the theory? Savarkar brought in first. Jinnah followed the suit. That's why when there was a controversy about Aligarh, I had to say it and write somewhere that the Hindu right has more in common with Jinnah than Muslims. And in fact, the whole Pakistan resolution, when it was passed, when Hindu Mahasabha and Muslim League were coalition partners. So the point I'm trying to draw home is this: look at Deen Dayal Upadhyay. Aapne sun liya hoga, aajkal har scheme ka naam Deen Dayal Upadhyay pe hai. Even Deen Dayal Upadhyay is talking of loose confederation between India and Pakistan. And who was he? From Hindu Mahasabha, the 1952 Johnson Manifesto says, we have unassailable conviction about Akhand Bharat. Of course, Ram Manohar Lohia also in 1962 said partition is artificial. Karju says Pakistan is a fake country. Sri Aurobindo also said we should have Akhand Bharat. Bala Sahib Devras, on March 12, 1979, as late as 1979, when Bangladesh has also come into existence, he absolutely ruled out war with Pakistan. And what did he say? That we need to wait for the sober elements in Pakistan and Bangladesh to understand the futility of partition so that we can come together. And then he gives a roadmap of it. First, we will come together for economic reasons. You know, India has given a most favored nation to Pakistan, which was recently after Balakot was withdrawn, but will be very soon given back once the government comes in. Even if the same government comes in, don't worry about it. This keeps happening. So first we will have better economic trade relations, and then we will convert ourselves into a sort of loose confederation. If idea is Akhand Bharat, throwing these immigrants or illegal immigrants or Bangladeshis or termites or whatever you want to call them, I believe is a stupid idea. Because then you are saying that Bangladesh is not part of Akhand Bharat, and which negates the Jansang and RSS fundamental philosophy. Now, on the question of citizenship, you need to understand that in the Constituent Assembly, Ambedkar is on record that no subject has given the drafting committee as much headache as the question of citizenship. And Ambedkar, who was the chairman of the drafting committee, also says, I don't know how many drafts were prepared and how many drafts were destroyed. And then finally you get a law, which I consider is a very, very liberal law. I don't know how many of you have traveled to US, but as and when, and I wish sooner, when you go to US, you will see many females in their late pregnancy travel to United States. Why? So that the child takes birth on the soil of United States. And every child who takes birth on the soil of United States gets the US citizenship. Of course, Trump has some different ideas, but he has been opposed by everyone. What citizen is not there in the Indian Constitution? What citizen has not been defined in the Indian Constitution? But Indian Constitution, Part 2, you know, has Articles 5 to 11, which talk of citizenship. And these provisions will come into force. Those of you who are writing civil services exam should know, the citizenship law and part of the Constitution came into force on 26 November 1949 itself. So it first came into force. The rest of the Constitution will come into force on the Republic Day on January 26, 1949. Now, citizenship and state are deeply embedded concepts. You cannot think of citizenship without a state. And a state is not a great thing. It is an instrument of exploitation. It is an instrument of oppression. Even though Hegel will say that it is a march of God on earth, George Orwell would say, Big Brother, and we can see how state controls us. Through passport, they monitor our movement, where we are going, when we are going, for how long we are going. Through Aadhaar, you have seen how surveillance regime has come into play, and in spite of Supreme Court's judgment, an ordinance in the last meeting of the cabinet was promulgated on this. But citizenship as an idea, it promises equality and integration within a political community, within a state, that everybody will be equal. What I am going to demonstrate to you in a minute as a teacher, that I have a problem with the very idea of citizenship. And that's why of the 4 or 5 articles I have written on NRC and citizenship, I first wrote on this, that the idea of citizenship is an idea of exclusion. It is not an idea of inclusion. It says other, the concept of other is brought in by citizenship. But theoretically speaking, citizenship would talk that a political community comes into existence when people agree to live together within a framework of mutually agreed and recognized rules, consenting to give to a sovereign political authority. What kind of authority? The power to enforce these rules. And this consent, every 5 years, they need to renew. That's why you are having elections these days. Because we have to renew our consent or withdraw our consent. Idea of citizenship does go beyond legal and formal membership of the terms of the belonging. And therefore, the distinctions of gender, caste and class, ethnicity and sexuality should ideally not be there. Everybody is just citizen. That is the ideal idea of citizenship. So citizenship is identified with an ideal condition of equality. Everybody is equal. It may actually remain this kind of equality, I believe, and Arunan Roy argues this, may actually remain elusive and fettered since societies have hierarchies. And because of societal inequalities, societal hierarchies, citizenship does not give us that substantive equality under which everybody is equal. So citizenship, rather than removing equalities, produces hierarchies by laying down terms of inclusion. When will you be in? They write these terms of inclusion, and these terms of inclusion manifest through two processes. One is the process of masking, and other is the process of marking. So masking means that the citizenship expects disassociation. Now you are not a Brahmin and a Shudra and a Vaishna, so the caste should go. A new mask of citizenship comes in. You are not a Muslim and a Hindu and a Jew and Christian, you are just an Indian citizen, so these things should go. You are not from North and South, or from Mumbai or non-Mumbai, or you are not a male or female or a third gender, and you are not having this he or she or sexuality. Sexual minorities are also entitled to very same rights. So citizenship will have a mask which somewhat remove all other kinds of classes within the society. But then citizenship also does marking. And how does it mark? It says, these are not the citizens. And if these are not the citizens, then they should not have right. Unfortunately, Indian Constitution does not believe in such a narrow vision. The framers of the Constitution are not politicians of today's generation, who just to stay in power can do and talk any nonsense. Many rights, even to non-citizens. So a non-citizen also has right to equality. Article 14 is not confined to just citizens. It says no one shall be deprived of equality before law and equal protection of laws. Right to life. No one shall be deprived of life or personal liberty. And when we are talking of 21, life and personal liberty, it says to live with human dignity. If you look at the condition of detention cells, these people are not living with dignity. The people whom you are calling D-voters or whom you are calling illegal migrants, you are violating their right to life. Similarly, freedom of religion, available to everyone, whether you are an Indian or a non-Indian, everyone has freedom of religion as a fundamental right. It is only Article 19 fundamental rights which are confined to citizens of India. But rest of the fundamental right, most of the fundamental rights, we are giving even to non-citizens. Now, once you are a citizen, ideally, the citizenship concept should remove your classifications and create a kind of a universality and create a kind of an egalitarianism, and you should not have any other distinctions. But don't we have some super citizens? Durga Vahini in UP of Yogi Adityanath ji. If you are connected with RSS or if you are connected with a ruling party, so when Mayawati ji is in power, then one group becomes super citizen. When Akhilesh is in power, another group becomes super citizen. And then there are people who are excluded, though they are a citizen. Look what we have done with Dalits. Remember that famous Una video, somebody beating these Dalits and then also proudly uploading it. And then Supreme Court even trying to dilute SCST atrocities law, or minorities, or even women, or indigenous people. So you have so many people within your society who, though citizens, but are not equal. And I feel like hanging my head in shame when even judges talk in these terms. Recall that assassination of, brutal murder of young engineer Mohsin in Pune, and giving bail to the accused, the judge is saying that religion of the victim and attire of the victim I take as a good provocation, and that's how the accused got provoked. It is an utter nonsense, unheard of. You are trying to mark people and deny those people certain rights, and you are putting in additional conditions. Like Hindustan mein rehna hai, to bande matram kehna hoga. Of course, I don't mind. Of course, many people don't oppose this kind of thing. But if somebody really has some issue, can it be a condition that if you do this, then you are entitled to citizenship? I believe this is not right. And that's why citizenship, I believe, is a condition of hierarchical inequalities, and large masses of our citizens are excluded, and they may be called subject, they may be called insurgent, they may be called gendered citizens, they may be called sexual minorities, they may be called HIV positive peoples. So this distinction should ideally go. Now, one more idea on citizenship, which I feel like sharing with the audience in Aligarh Muslim University. Citizenship as a universal equalizing principle, where all your identities vanish and only one identity should ideally remain, many a times you see an exception of this. And an exception of this, I want to talk this afternoon in the context of people who are asserting Assami culture, Assami language. BJP got it completely wrong when they thought in this citizenship bill that it is a Hindu-Muslim thing, which can give them good votes in the plains. When NDTV 24/7 was interviewing me on this, and he said that this can polarize, do this and that, but you see so much of opposition in Northeast. BJP's own governments in Meghalaya and other northeastern states passing resolutions against it. I told the anchor, oh man, they are not doing it for those 14, 17, 20 seats in Northeast. They are doing it for UP, for Madhya Pradesh, for Bihar and other places in the plains, where you have more than 200 seats for the grab. And the idea is, oh, we have shown them the door. And that idea is, in my opinion, problematic. So you are an Indian citizen, but this Indian citizenship does not completely erase your another identity. Another identity is, I am Assami. Assami culture, Assami language. And therefore, many a times there are groups which are citizens at one level, but they are a member of another group. And they want to preserve their that group identity, be it as Muslims, or be it as Tamil people, or Telugu people, or others. And that's how you have a whole idea of religious and linguistic minorities who want to preserve as a group their group identity, and constitution says that they can fully do it. This is the whole idea of what is called differentiated citizenship. Now, when Article 29 and 30 is talking of preservation of your distinctive culture, language and script, the Constitution is recognizing that in addition to your universal citizenship, there is another identity as a member of a group which must be preserved and which must be cherished. So law need not be blind to differences. And a state many a times cannot be a neutral arbiter. As you come to the question of citizenship, better principle is you give citizenship on the basis of birth, jus solis as it is called. If you are taken birth in India, you will get Indian citizenship. People who may have come in 1966, many of them must have died. People who came even in 71, many of them must have died. But people, largely the people who are there now in Assam, they are younger people, and most of them, in my opinion, have taken birth on our soil. Same is the case with many Rohingyas, that there are many Rohingya children who have taken birth in India. And according to our principle and the universal principle globally recognized in better countries, liberal countries, you should ideally give citizenship on the basis of birth. The other idea, or a narrower idea, is of giving citizenship on a principle called jus sanguinis, where you look at the blood ties. I feel that the recent amendments starting after this Assam Accord or so, we have been going in a negative direction, where we have been trying to emphasize the blood relationship. And therefore, initially we said that, oh, you should be born here and then you should be resident and one of your parents should have Indian citizenship. And then subsequently we said, no, both parents should have Indian citizenship. Or one parent should have an Indian citizenship and other parents should not be an illegal migrant. I believe all these restrictions somewhat compromise the liberal citizenship law which India had promised. Now, since in law faculty and elsewhere also, we do not teach citizenship law, which is crucial and which everyone should know, you should understand that Constitution straight away said that on the commencement of the Constitution, anyone who is born in India, domicile in India, or his parent has been an Indian citizen will get citizenship. But we were also tackling with the situation of migration, because country was partitioned, unfortunately. And therefore, there were people who had gone to Pakistan. There were people who had come from the Pakistan. There were people who had gone Pakistan and then come back. And therefore, the citizenship law takes care of such situations. So if you have migrated to Pakistan before July 19, 1948, and you are an ordinary resident of India, then automatic citizenship. if you had gone and come back, or you migrated from there after July 19, 1948, you have to get yourself registered. Now, the point I am trying to draw home that in Assam, as you look at the whole crisis, the Muslim connection in Assam is as old as some 1200 years or so. Not 1200, in 1206, I think, this Bakhtiar Khilji will go there, will not win, and then subsequently next year you will get this kind of thing. So the Muslims are there for quite some time, since 13th century or so. And you had other speakers talking to you that all through there has been waves of migration. The border is porous, therefore this 1948, 19 July deadline, which you had for the Western Pakistan, it could not be applied to the Eastern Pakistan. And therefore you got a Nehru-Liaquat Pact, which changed this date. And then subsequently, as you got creation of Bangladesh, again there was statements made, and then you had this whole agitations. And finally, you got the Assam Accord. And now what they are saying, that if you came before 1966, which is not the deadline for Western Pakistan, then you are Indian citizen. If you came between 1966 and 71, for 10 years you will not have a voting right, but you will have all other rights. And after 10 years you will also get the voting right. If you came after 25th March 1971, when Bangladesh was created, then you are illegal migrant and you are to be detected and deported. Now my whole problem with the kind of narrative which is being presented, and you just heard that these figures don't make any sense. There is so much of irrationality in the political discourse, motivated political discourse, that you feel like, you know, abusing people and telling them what nonsense they are talking. We heard this narrative that Muslim growth rate is very high, and you know, in so many years they will outnumber Hindus. Statistically, it is not possible. It is rubbish. In fact, if you look at the decline in growth rate, since census is done every 10 years, it is in terms of decadal decline. The steepest decline in growth rate is amongst the Muslims. As more Muslims get education, you know, having fertility, as Bahar was talking about, has to do with education. It doesn't have to do with your religion, you know. Kerala Muslims have as low fertility rate as other people in Kerala. But UP Hindus or Bihar Hindus have more fertility rate than the Kerala Muslims. So in any case, in Assam, compared to national average, in some decades there was higher growth rate. But this whole narrative that you have so many lakhs and crores of Bangladeshis, it is not made out. And this gentleman, you know what kind of governors BJP appoints. We have been talking about Congress governors, but you have seen Election Commission talking about Kalyan Singh. You have another governor in Northeast talking about all nonsense. So Mr. S.K. Sinha, and it was a Vajpayee regime, he himself in column 13 of that famous, infamous report of chapter 2, Migration into Assam, admitted, this is an admission from the same report I am quoting, no census has been carried out to determine the number of these illegal migrants. Precise and authentic figures are not available. But on the basis of estimates, extrapolations, and various indicators, this number runs into millions. This is from the same report. And if you look at this atrocious report, which gives all kind of imaginary and whimsical figures, you feel like, what kind of governor is he? And why Supreme Court is accepting this report as if it is like a gospel truth? We know governors give the same report which center asks. They more are like agents of the center in the state. So you saw recently in Goa, 2 a.m. in night, two MLAs defecting, oath taking place, isn't so? Leader of the single majority party not sworn in, all kinds of things. In fact, if you, since you know, I was taught history in Aligarh by Professor Irfan Habib and others. So I somewhere wrote that Mughal governors were very independent in the sense that as and when they got a chance to rebel against the central authority, they will declare themselves independent. The British brought in this idea of loyal governors, about whom it is said that ideally a governor should be a disabled person who should not even walk. He should have some leisure, read some novels, books, etc. Or koi kaam maan nahi hai governor ka. Isn't so? So, independent India's governors were like this. Whatever center wants, that kind of reports they give. And therefore, this report, which now unfortunately Supreme Court accepts without any scrutiny, is the primary cause of whole problem of NRC. These people are not able to make distinction between Lower Assam and other places in Assam, and how influx has happened, how in border areas, you know, situation is fluid, and there are border areas where Muslims have been there since Akbar's time. But as you look at the whole numbers, the argument right now is, I don't know whether Vadud, I am right. If you look at some of the cases, and this is the current case which has to go to the Constitution Bench. In fact, the Constitution Bench already was constituted. It had one hearing, then Justice Pant retired and the bench got dissolved, but it has to come back. And the idea is that Section 6A, under which current NRC is being undertaken, its constitutionality has been challenged. And if Section 6A is not constitutional, I think BJP in the first place should clarify, are they okay with 1971 deadline? If you look at this case, they are not okay with that. And if this date becomes 1948, like the western border, then the number will not be 40 million. It will go you know, really up. So if you look at these cases, I really feel sorry that the Supreme Court of India is blindly quoting with from them. And then they are saying that, no, this 19, this IMDT Act, there was a tribunal set up, you know, 1983, which was struck down in this case by the Supreme Court. And they said, no, the 46 Foreigners Act, that was good. And this one 1983 Act is bad. There are students of law, and of course, we have some very eminent lawyers here. I was taught by very competent teachers here in Aligarh Law Faculty. So I was taught constitutional law by Professor Rekhi. And now I am myself teaching it for years. Central law is questioned. There are only two tests. One is, does the parliament have the power to pass this law? So the only thing you have to see is this item, subject, on which a law has been enacted, is it in the state list? If it is in the state list, it is unconstitutional. The other is, even though the law is not in the state list, it is very much in the union list, the parliament has the power to pass such a law, but it violates fundamental rights. I have not seen a single, I am saying it with full sense of responsibility, single instance of any law being struck down on the ground it is an inefficient law. We passed the Dowry Prohibition Act. The problem of dowry is very much there. Can we strike it down as unconstitutional? Number of laws we have which are not implemented on ground. Even look at the rate of murders. Can we say, no, this IPC, replace it, bring some other law. This law is more efficient than that law. You cannot strike down a law by saying X law was better than the Y law. The principle is lex posterior. Whichever law comes after, that is the law. Because legislature, in its wisdom, has thought fit to bring such a law. I feel that the judgment is problematic because it challenges the wisdom of the legislature, which is not right. And therefore, to say that the 46th law, Foreigners Act, on burden of proof, was better than the 1983 Act, I think is wrong. Yeah, I'm finishing. Just 1 minute. Similarly, to say that this law applies only to Assam and it does not apply to whole of India and therefore it violates Article 14, I think is utter nonsense. We know under Article 14, there can be a law even against one individual. Chiranjit Lal case. Article 14 prohibits class legislation. It permits classification. So there can be a law against one state. You have so many special status provisions in the constitution. Mizoram has this, Arunachal has this, Andhra Pradesh has this, Telangana has this, Kashmir has this. There can be a law even for one city. There can be a law even for one person. So that, I believe, again, is not the right thing to talk about in terms of citizenship. And Supreme Court's opinion that the geographical considerations cannot be taken into account is, in fact, geographical considerations are to be taken into account. I give you a current example. Supreme Court said that you will not have a liquor sale on highways. And if you want, so within the 5 meters radius of a highway, liquor will not be sold. Then they had to amend this law. They said if it is a hilly region, this direction will not apply to them. Of course, the original Supreme Court judgment is also not very wise, because what it is saying, if you want to drink on highway, take it from your home. Your whole dicky may have 500 bottles, but don't purchase on the way. But if you want, you just drive 500 meters, get whatever number of bottles you want. Get my point? So this is, I feel, is another thing. And thirdly, just now I told you that Article 21 is applicable even to non-citizens. Supreme Court saying that 21 right of fair criminal procedure cannot be extended to deportation proceedings is negation of everything for which Indian Constitution stands for and negation of modern international law. And if this is so, that if an earlier law is better than the later law and therefore the earlier law should be there, then let us go back to 1955 Citizenship Act. All the amendments are bad then. All the amendments are negation of liberal principles of citizenship. And that's why I feel that there is more to this. As many as 13 questions have been referred to the Constitution bench. And till Supreme Court decide the constitutionality, I consider whole NRC as suspect. One more minute I will take. Some chakmas have also come from Bangladesh to India. How courts have taken up their issue? Now, these chakmas are Buddhist, and if you compare that, this can be one of the projects for law students sitting here. You will see that they got a much more favorable response from the Supreme Court. I hope that citizenship should be a subject on which more workshops should be organized, because you simply don't know what does it mean to not have citizenship tag. I feel it is a good initiative of the union that on such a serious topic, and so many of you are able to come. I am grateful to you for patient hearing, but believe me that from Nalsar, for instance, I sent one team to go and look at the detention centers. Aligarh Muslim University's law students in particular, and even other students who want to be human rights defenders and activists, have to take up as a project and spend their summer or winter vacations there and then come up with reports how these tribunals are working, what kind of hearing they are giving, and if we can make a proper dossier, someday it will help. Thank you very much.